If you've spent any time on TireRack.com or if you've watched our previous test videos, you probably know that we divide tires into specific performance categories. And maybe you've wondered what the difference is from one category to the next.
Yeah, so we thought it would be helpful to talk about some of the most popular passenger car tire categories out there and perform a test to see how they may affect you as a driver and consumer if you choose, say, one performance category over another. So we'll start with the touring tires and kind of work our way up from there.
So we're starting with standard touring all-season tires. And like the name implies, these are touring products. They're expected to be smooth, quiet, and comfortable out there on the road. And since they're all-season, they're also expected to deliver at least a minimum competency in wet and wintertime traction as well.
Absolutely. But what sets standard touring all-season tires apart from their other touring counterparts is they tend to have more of a focus on tread life, so they're designed to last longer. What some people may or may not realize is that can come at the expense of other performance attributes.
The two tires that we've chosen to represent the category are the Goodyear Assurance Max Life and the Yokohama Avid Ascend LX. They're both strong tires, they've tested well in our program, they rate highly in our consumer rankings, and they're just kind of representative of the category as a whole. And the reason we're doing that is we don't want to test tires that are outliers, we want products that are representative for this test.
Exactly.
It's soft, it rounds things over very well, but I would say it does that at the expense of a little bit of composure, a little bit of control, because you do notice a little bit of jiggle, as we sometimes like to call it.
Very technically accurate, but it was jiggly.
What do you think about noise here?
It's quiet, it's doing a good job keeping the cross-cut concrete at a like kind of a lower baseline.
Let's talk about steering. What's going on with the steering?
Traditionally not a high point, and turns out still not a high point. It's a little vague, a little wandery, just not what this performance category is set out to do. It's right. Not its main goal in life.
Right. The average 60 to 0 mile an hour braking distance for the standard touring all season tires in our test was 174.9 feet. That's over 40 feet longer than the Max Performance summer tires and 26 feet longer than the Ultra High Performance all-season tires. Similarly, they had the least lateral traction on the skid pad and the slowest lap times by a huge margin.
Traction, not all that impressive it seems. The steering isn't really as sharp or precise as some of the other categories.
The biggest thing that jumps out at me immediately is just how it can't hold its intended line through a corner, especially like a long, fast, sweeping corner. It just wants to plow to the outside.
So just general all around, a step down in traction in exchange, presumably, for the additional tread life that they provide. Just like in the wet, the standard touring all-season tires were at the bottom of the charts for dry traction and performance. This time, they were closer to their fellow all-season counterparts, requiring just 3 feet longer to stop from 60 than the Grand Touring all-season tires, and 11 feet more than the ultra-high performance all-season entries. Their lateral traction and lap times were commensurately slower as well.
And this performance category is not meant for dry track handling in a BMW 330. It'll do it, but it'll do it reluctantly. Steering is, well, how is it, TJ?
The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, as they say.
That's deep.
Yeah. It's not happy being out here doing this. This is not what these tires were made for.
No.
Okay, standard touring all season. What did we find out?
They were very nice on the road. In fact, tied with the best in the test. However, they were kind of at the back of the pack, sometimes by a huge amount in dry and wet traction.
Right. We'll still see how they perform in the winter, but as of right now, it seems like the long tread life is really kind of the primary reason to choose a tire from the category.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to Grand Touring All Season. And these are arguably the most well-rounded products out there on the market because they're expected to do everything pretty well.
Right.
So they should have good ride quality and noise comfort, strong wet traction, decent light snow traction, even good tread life and some, you know, fun to drive characteristics too.
Yeah, absolutely. So Grand Touring All Season, we have the Falcon Sincera SN250AS and the Pirelli Cinturato Weather Active. Now the Cinturato Weather Active is an all-weather tire, so it's a Grand Touring All Season tire with the Three Peak Mountain Snowflake symbol. The Falcon does not have that symbol, but it's still a Grand Touring All Season, so we kind of have one from each camp here.
It's not so focused on absolute softness that it gives up the composure and the controlled nature, which is really what we kind of like I said, have come to expect from Grand Touring All Season products. And noise on this tire, we were both really happy with it, honestly. It is just level and even and doesn't create any real distinctive tones.
Yeah.
Mr. Driver, what do you think about steering?
Wonderful. It's progressive with its input, it's linear in its response. What more do you want?
Right, it's kind of direct, it points the vehicle well. It doesn't feel like performance tire urgent, but it's just right. It's similar to the ride in that it's touring, but with a little bit of a sporty flair to it, you know?
The Grand Touring All Season tires averaged a little over 166 feet to come to a stop from 60 miles per hour. This figure, along with their 0.68 Gs of lateral traction and 33 3/4 second lap times, were still far off the capabilities of performance tires, especially the summer performance tires.
Steering precision is up, absolute traction, lateral traction is up, braking traction is up.
It does not have the outright traction of any of the tires from the performance categories.
No.
For everyday around town type driving, wet roads, I'd say this does fit the bill pretty well.
The Grand Touring All Season tires in our test inched closer to the dry traction of the performance tires, but they are still at the back of the pack, just barely ahead of their standard Touring All Season counterparts. On average, they managed 0.85 Gs around the skid pad and required a little over 121 feet to come to a stop from 60 miles per hour.
It's limited by its overall traction, that all-season compound that has to do so many things.
Yeah.
Really, dry laps aren't on that checklist of all the things it has to do, but it's like it has good bones, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it feels like there's nice construction here. It dances around a little bit. It changes directions nicely. And it's like, if you aren't going for the absolute fastest lap,
it's satisfying to drive,
isn't it?
So from what we've seen in this test, the Grand Touring All Season tires are nearly as smooth, quiet, and comfortable as the standard Touring All Season products, and they're a little bit nicer to drive.
Yeah, and they have good to very good wet and dry traction, but nothing great.
Okay, on to our first performance tire category of the test, ultra high performance all season. And tires from this category tend to be available in lower profile sizes, and they sort of favor performance vehicles.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that you can't put them on your family sedan or your small SUV.
Oh, absolutely. So ultra high performance tends to focus a little more on driving dynamics and wet and dry traction. And sometimes that can come at the expense of absolute comfort, tread life, and winter traction.
Yep, and to represent the category, we have the BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 AS Plus and the Michelin Pilot Sport All Season 4. These are two huge names in the segment, so let's see what they can do.
It's firmer than anything else that we've driven. You feel the big hits. You feel all of the little hits. It doesn't hide anything that's going down at the road, but it does a good job of, to the best of a performance tire's abilities, mitigating those things.
Yeah.
And that's what a good UHP all season tire does.
A lot of times we start to hear more volume, but also more kind of variety of tones, more cyclical pattern noise.
Yes. It's kind of the nature of the beast. Like, these tires try to serve so many purposes, try to be so many things. It's like, it is tough to get away from.
It's not bad.
I agree. It's not bad. You know what else isn't bad?
What?
The steering on this tire.
Yeah.
It's hefty, it's direct, it's
got great
firm,
return to center.
Return to center. You can tell, like, that is one thing that you don't realize you miss with touring tires until you get into a good performance tire. It's like, this tire wants to travel straight ahead.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like you can take your hands off the wheel. Don't do that, but it feels like you can take your hands off the wheel and it wants to move forward. You turn, it feels like it wants to return itself to top dead center. And that's a traditionally performance tire trait that we are very, very fond of.
Switching from touring categories to a performance category, we saw huge gains in wet traction. The ultra-high performance all-season tires' 148-foot braking distances were 1 to 2 car lengths shorter than the touring tires. And their advantage in lateral traction and lap times were immediately noticeable, even from the passenger seat.
This tire feels pretty pointy, pretty strong. I wish it responded a little bit faster.
Yeah, the steer is more precise. It's more, dare I say, elegant.
Yeah,
it does feel like an upgrade, especially in the steering department. I am 100% on board with that.
In our dry objective testing, the ultra-high performance all-season tires were a noticeable improvement over their touring counterparts. They shaved a little less than a car length off the 60 to 0 mile an hour braking distances, and their added athleticism resulted in lap times that were about a third of a second faster.
We've been making incremental gains, and that continues. It's not exactly super responsive, but it feels hefty and deliberate, and it just goes right where you want it to. Balance front to rear is nice. Braking traction is nice. Just overall, it's a good driving tire.
So we found in our testing that ultra high performance all season tires do tend to ride a little bit rougher and they're a little noisier, but they do offer more driving enjoyment and a big increase in wet and dry traction over their touring tire counterparts.
Moving on to summer only products. First up, Max Performance Summer. Now, these tires are designed to be the flagship performance tires for their respective manufacturers. So that means they're expected to maximize wet traction, dry traction, even relative on-road refinement and tread life.
Yeah.
Of course, they are not intended to be used in freezing temperatures and definitely not in the snow or on the ice.
No. So Max Performance Summer, we have the Michelin Pilot Sport 4S, and it's a category benchmark. It's well loved by customers and well tested by us. And then we have the Fredestein Alltrack Pro. That's actually a new untested product for us, and it's supposed to be more of a kinder, gentler Max Performance Summer tire. So speaking of that, let's see how they do on the road.
And in terms of ride, it's firm. Very good composure, but if you're looking for, you know, ultimate comfort, maybe Max Performance Summer isn't the right category for you anyway, right?
Yeah, it's gonna focus maximally on performance.
Tell me about noise also. What do you think about the noise on this tire?
It does a very good job of staying consistent.
They need to be, at least somewhat refined, quiet, comfortable. And so it does a good job kind of keeping things under control. It's not out of control noise, but again, like you said, there is some volume there.
Oh, that steering though.
I know, right? That is one of the hallmarks of the Max Performance Summer category is steering feel. And this one absolutely goes right along with that. It is hefty, it is direct, it is precise, it is responsive.
The Max Performance Summer tires were dominant in 60 to 0 braking, bringing the vehicle to a stop 30 to 40 feet shorter than the touring tires and 14 to 20 feet shorter than the other performance categories. They were excellent in our track laps as well. One of the pair was the fastest tire on the test, while the other was slightly off that pace, which allowed the Extreme Performance Summer tire to sneak in a virtual tie in the final results.
Yeah, this feels like a Max Performance Summer tire.
Perception's reality, TJ.
Yeah. These tires don't have to make any compromises for wintertime traction, so it's just wet and dry. That's what they get to focus on.
It's great. It's refreshing to drive these Max Performance Summer tires.
In our dry objective testing, the Max Performance Summer tires delivered strong braking and lateral traction figures, with our team once again experiencing a noticeable improvement in braking distances around a car's length and a palpable 400ths of a G increase in lateral grip above the ultra-high performance all-season tires.
It is a big step difference. We were finding, you know, incremental gains moving from one all-season category to the next. When you jump from ultra-high performance all-season to Max Performance Summer, it opens up a totally different world. It is just unbelievably more capable in really every way.
Yeah.
If we're talking steering responsiveness or feel, if we're talking handling, if we're talking ultimate braking or cornering traction, it is just a big step up.
The Max Performance Summer tires really did everything well.
Yeah.
They were the best of all the performance products on the road.
Yeah.
They were the best in the test in the wet, and they were second only to the Extreme Performance Summer tire in the dry.
Yeah, but drawbacks, don't forget, they're not as comfortable or as quiet as the touring tires, and of course won't last as long as touring tires either. And don't forget, you can't use them in the cold or the winter.
Right, but that's not necessarily a drawback for everybody. And we're gonna demonstrate that with the winter portion of this test. The last category in the test, and what's definitely the most focused category, is Extreme Performance Summer.
Yeah.
Tires from the Extreme Performance Summer category are hyper-focused on dry traction and dry performance. They're even good for like racing and autocross use.
Yeah, so generally you are always gonna sacrifice on-road comfort and hydroplaning resistance, and of course tread life, when you go to an Extreme Performance Summer tire. And of course, you can't forget, like all summer tires, but especially these, they cannot be driven or even serviced in freezing or near freezing temperatures.
Right, and the tire that we chose to represent the category is the Bridgestone Potenza RE71RS. Now, admittedly, We included an extreme performance summer tire in this test because we like to drive them. But also, we thought it's important to let you know what's out there and what's possible for people who are interested.
It's extreme.
Right away, it's extreme. You feel it. It is stiff. Big bumps, little bumps, cracks, imperfections, tar strips. You feel everything.
And honestly, it doesn't care. It doesn't care about your feelings because it's here to do one thing.
Yep, same thing with noise. If being quiet is going to interfere with dry traction, yep, it doesn't care.
Okay.
No, I don't care. Then I'm going to be loud.
It's this thing is about one thing, and it's about extreme dry performance.
Can we say it's about another thing too, and that's steering?
Yeah.
Because the steering is wonderful.
It's fantastic. You want steering response, you want immediacy in your steering. Extreme performance is where it's at.
In the braking portion of the test, we're traveling at a little more than 60 miles an hour when we hit the brakes, and we experienced significant hydroplaning until the vehicle slowed down a bit, and then the braking traction was very good. Even so, the result was braking distances that were way off the max performance summer tires, and worse even than the UHP all season tires. The 0.75 Gs on the skid pad demonstrates the outright traction is good, and the wet lap time that technically led the test is an interesting component too. On our tight track, we don't quite see 60 miles an hour, so we don't deal with as much hydroplaning as we experienced in braking. This allowed the tire to utilize its athleticism and strong wet grip to set very fast laps.
These tires can be good in the wet, but if there's any kind of standing water, be very careful because they are not good at hydroplaning resistance.
Or if you're using them on the street or driving to an event and it's raining, especially if they've been through a few events, slow down.
Yep.
Everything is just super sharp. The steering is just an absolute beefcake. It's reassuring every corner.
Our extreme performance summer tire had the best dry performance of all the tires we tested. It's somewhat difficult to convey just how good the EP tire was in the dry with only words and numbers. But to try to put it in perspective, we saw a bigger improvement in braking, lateral traction, and lap times when moving from MP to EP than we did between the ultra high performance all season tires and the max performance summer tires.
This is so extreme.
It is extreme. Of this entire test, this is the only category of tire that we actually recommend doing this in. We recommend extreme performance summer tires for autocross, for track use, because that's what these things were designed for. This is where they are at home. And man, you can tell, just the steering is so quick, so responsive, and precise and accurate too.
Yeah. I don't know if you can feel this at home, but I mean, just the G-forces, I mean, you can feel it just multiplied. It's capable, it's fast.
Yes.
It's just a marked increase, even from the very good max performance summer tires. It's just a light switch.
So there really weren't any surprises on this one. Our testing showed the extreme performance summer tire was by far the best in dry traction and lap times.
Wet traction was strong too, but it struggled for hydroplaning resistance at higher speeds. And as we kind of expected, it was coarse and unrefined on the road. Yep. We know it's built for smiles, not miles, and winter driving is a no-go too.
So what do we find out?
Well, generally, we can conclude there are differences between categories.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes those differences are huge, and sometimes they're a little bit closer together.
And sometimes it's just kind of a matter of how those performance attributes are distributed. You know, give a little here, take a little there, but the overall kind of units of performance remains the same.
So to sum it all up, if you're looking for the highest level of comfort and quiet on the road, the touring categories are probably best for you. If you're looking for dry traction, a performance summer tire is best, or ultra-high performance all season if light snow capability is a requirement.
And if you're looking for wet traction, max performance summer would be the best, with ultra-high performance all season as a year-round option. And if you're looking for maximum longevity, standard touring or grand touring all season would be the best choice.
Since the summer tire categories can't be used in the snow or on the ice, we're going to substitute a studless ice and snow winter tire to demonstrate what you can expect if you choose to run dedicated, season-specific tires.
So thanks for watching.
We hope this was really helpful, and be on the lookout for the winter component of the video after our 2025 winter testing.